The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 72.38. Right now it's down by about 10 points. That's a 0.1% at 72.28. Joining us now for his take on the markets, Luis Limlingan of Regina Capital. Hi, Luis. Good morning.
Good morning, Mimi.
Okay, so is there any part of the market that you feel is running hot right now? I mean, I just noticed that the smaller, more speculative issues, the same ones that beat everybody else last year, are still charging up. You're talking about PHA, Apollo Global, for example. I mean, how much more room do they have to run?
Well, I think it's really the flavor of the month right now. And the issue changes every 2 weeks, I guess. People want to speculate. They've seen what's been happening in the U.S. They're looking for the next Amazon, the next Tesla, for example. These are companies that started small. And of course, it's possible that the room for growth is much higher. The ceiling is much higher. The second thing I would like to probably point out is maybe a lot of these investors, they've invested in these mutual funds, which track the index. So if I am an active investor, I probably have a portfolio where I put it in funds, right? Mm-hmm. So that's something that's rather passive. And now I want to put it in something that's more aggressive, and that's why probably I'm looking at these second and third liners.
Mm-hmm. But when do you expect the blue chips to catch up?
Well, blue chips are rather cyclical. Mm-hmm. One is you look at the fund flows. If you see net foreign buying or selling, there is a signal from the foreigners to come back into the Philippines. Now, a lot of things are probably tying us down. It's when will the vaccine, make its way into the country, and it'll feed into the general population. Second is for earnings clarity. Every quarter we get the round of earnings that come out and the growth numbers as well. So any indication that we're already poised to rebound will probably send signals that it's really time to come into the market.
Mm-hmm. But would you recommend investors to go for value at this point? And how is the earnings trend looking like for cyclical value stocks? We were just talking about it. Usually these cyclical stocks look good post-recession. So it's a matter of timing.
Definitely it's a matter of timing, and everyone is free to speculate. You really have to balance it out with looking at value stocks, blue chip stocks. Probably if you want to speculate as well, leave a portion. But I think, again, I think it's really prudent to, partition it accordingly, right? Because, again, even if, like right now, the second and third liners are moving, there's going to come a point when the blue chips as well are going to be taking off. Mm-hmm. So you don't want to focus all your efforts there. You also want to play it out. I guess it's really a time issue at this point. For example, I think there's the rebalancing next month, so probably some index names that are going to be upweight or downweight, you may want to make respective bets there as well. Same time, again, with the second and third liners, with each development, everyone wants to, I guess, placing money accordingly as well.
Mm-hmm. Let's now go over some interesting corporate stories, Luis. Let's start with this. Ayala Land and A-REIT have signed a deal, in fact, for A-REIT to buy the 30th, which is a mall along Pasig, for 5.1 billion pesos. I guess the question is, are you still betting big on REITs? Because aside from A-REIT, the first one for the country, there are four more coming online this year.
But the selling point of the REITs, really, it's rather stable because you're really buying it for the dividend income. And that's why you should make the distinction clearly when you buy a REIT versus Ayala Land. Mm-hmm. Because for the Ayala Land, you're betting on the property market as a whole because you have residential, office space, and the retail sector. But for REIT, you're more dependent on the dividend income, which I think with the deal that they signed with Ayala 30th, it's going to raise their prospect. But you're getting, for the trade-off, you're getting around 5 to 6%. So if you're happy with that, then it's fine. But if you want to just put your money on the prospects of the property market as a whole, then you should go to Ayala Land. So that's really what you're getting if you get A-REIT versus Ayala.
Okay. Other interesting stories, Philodrill is assigned operator of service contract 53, which is onshore Mindoro. That's after a redistribution. Here's one. BSP earnings slipping 14% to just 34.5 billion in the first 11 months of last year due to lower revenues and forex losses. Let's talk about foreign exchange. The peso has been strong. What outlook are you taking for the peso?
Well, right now we think the peso will, at least for the first half, it's more predictable to see, because I think the U.S. is really trying to stimulate the economy. You see that with the new stimulus plan, they're going to be issuing checks. I think it's around $600, right? And then the contention was, which is, are they going to raise it to $2,000? So I think a lot of money printed on the U.S. system will depreciate the greenback further. But moving forward, it's rather hazy at this point, because we don't know again when there's going to be recovery. I think the BSP has made it clear that they're going to keep interest rates low and probably they won't be moving for the time being. Mm-hmm. So that will protect us against any depreciation. But again, this is only for the near term. Again, after June, for example, it's going to be interesting how things are going to pan out.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk more about the currency later, but here's another interesting report that we're getting. Cesar Consing, which is leading a group of banks, says that he is seeing non-performing loans or bad loan ratio peaking at 6-7% this year, with recovery seen for 3-4 years, in a 3-4 year time period. Are you aligned with this expectation? I know that last year the central bank said they expect NPL ratios to peak at 4.6%, rather to reach 4.6% by December of 2020. So that's not, it seems like the banks are not yet out of the woods. If you're talking about a 6-7% non-performing loan ratio, that's worse for this year.
To be fair, I don't think any industry at this point is out of the woods. Mm-hmm. Yes, probably, you know, non-performing loans are going to increase, but that's a function of how long we've been suffering from this pandemic. I think 6 months ago, people were anticipating that probably the economy and Metro Manila is going to open up. People are free to travel, do business, you know, shops can stay open late. And, you know, we can allow, I mean, there's no cap to the number of customers that come in and out with the foot traffic. But of course, we're changing our expectations. Probably they're being a bit more conservative. And I think it's also sending a signal to the banks to be careful as well, because that's how they're seeing it. Hopefully that doesn't happen, but I think they're trying to prepare for the worst outcome.
Mm-hmm. So if I'm an investor and I'm looking at banks, they've taken quite a beating last year. BDO, Metrobank, Security Bank, for example. Is it time to get in or wait because it's going to fall some more? What do you think?
That's really a tough call. I think you really have to base it on how soon you think the economy is going to recover. Mm-hmm. And this isn't, again, like any sort of, like the previous crisis we faced, right? So it's really a guessing game at this point. Sometimes I have to defer to medical experts when they tell us, you know, the speed of the vaccine and how it's going to come to the Philippines and the rest of Asia, its effectiveness. All these things are coming out. So there are a lot of moving parts. And just as I like to say, it's a moving target as well. Mm-hmm. Yes, the banks are quite risky at this point, but so is every other industry as well, because they face their share of headwinds. But of course, I wouldn't leave them out, because again, if the bank's prices right now are reflecting the current conditions. But if things suddenly change, then of course, everyone's going to be buying into the bank. So I wouldn't leave them out of the spotlight.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about a stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us, just describe. So what do you have for us this morning?
Well, this stock comes from our recent report. Right now, we have a whole recommendation on the stock. Well, we believe that the losses may extend, obviously because of the recovery, because of the industry that it's in, which is affected by COVID, which is in tourism. Just a few notes, the market cap of this stock is around 12 billion. Free float is rather high, so it's around close to 50%. And it's quite active. In fact, the beta of the stock is 1.5. So for every 1% that the index moves, it's going to move 1.5 times that.
Okay. And why do we like this stock again, considering it's, you know, in the tourism travel industry space, which is heavily battered by the pandemic?
Well, at least on our view, depending on the recovery, I think it's nice to try and cherry pick the stock when the price seems rather attractive. Mm. Again, 2021 still has a lot of uncertainty, but everyone is looking for at least the third or fourth quarter where there's going to be an immediate recovery. Hopefully that the vaccine comes in. There's going to be election spending as well. And of course, you know, the low base effect, I think, is going to help in part. So probably they should try looking at the stock more often and doing their research as well.
Okay, on that note, we're just going to have to guess. You know, to be fair, this is the first time we're getting this stock for the blind item, so it's going to be a challenging guess. Thank you so much, Luis, for joining us this morning. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you.